So friends, we continue with question number B3 of your functional budgets. B3 is a very simple, easy question, 3-4 marks question. You only need to understand there are two products, namely AB and CD, and there are four materials, namely A, B, C and D. If you understand this much, the question is easily done. So let us go through the question contents. Now below the first table, you are given budgeted sale quantity. What question wants me to make? Production budget, requirement budget and purchase budget. Requirement budget is consumption. Requirement and consumption are one and same thing. There will be making quantitative as well as monetary calculation. So, we start with the production budget here. If you look here, in tons, product AB, product CD. Question gives me below the first table, the sale quantity 60 and 200. Add closing stock. In the second table, all stock statements are there. AB and CD are second last column and last column. AB and CD. Don't confuse with A, B, C, D, they are materials. AB and CD are products. How did I get to know that they are products? Because they are being sold. Something produced, something sold is output. Something consumed, something purchased is input or material. So here I get the closing stocks 5 and 60, opening stocks 10 and 50. From there I am getting busted production of 55 and 200. First part is complete. 1 mark each, 3 parts are there. If it is 2 marks, it is bumper sale. So in exam, you rarely get that for 6 marks. It is for 3 marks only. Second part, materials requirement budget. Requirement means consumption. I need to get input-output ratio given in first table. For product AB, A requirement 80%, B requirement 20%, C and D are nil. In making product AB, which is 55 tons, 80% is A, 20% is B, 44 and 11. Nothing here, nil, C and D. Similarly, for product CD, 210 ton total, 50% C, 50% D. So, you are getting is 105 everywhere. So, what I am getting? This is in tons the consumption. Add them. Nothing to add, single item to be added. 44, 11, 105, 105. That is busted consumption quantity. Quantitative requirement budget is over, but I need monetary also. So multiply with the purchase price and add. I'll get total, I hope calculations you can check, 57,900 is the total material requirement in this question. So very easy. I keep on saying it's a very, very easy question. C point, purchase budget. For purchase, what I need to do? I need to make adjustment of closing stock and opening stock. Once I do that, I'll be able to get the purchase quantity. Multiply with purchase price per unit, I'll get the purchase amounts. So, consumption taken from B part that we have done. Add target ending inventory. Again, inventories are in second table. A, B, C, D separately. This is 20, 40, 300, 200. Opening inventory, 15, 10, 200, 250. Once I adjust, I get busted purchase quantity. This is busted purchase quantity. 49, 41, 205 and 55. Calculations you can verify. I hope they are all correct. Multiplied with purchase price. 500, 400, 200, 100 and 200, sorry. Once I multiply with these purchase prices, I'll get purchase cost. Add, you get total. 72,400 is a material purchase cost busted for the month of June. Nothing there, no income statement, nothing. Very simple, easy question. Reaching from sale till purchase. Started from sale, reached production. From production, we reach consumption. From consumption, we reach purchase. multiply with purchase price, and we get the purchase amount. That is C part. I hope this much is clear. Next question, B4, is also very simple. It is not difficult at all. It is purely for making production budget, nothing else. But over months, over 3 months, ending 31st March, means January, February, March, we are going to make production budget for the 3 months. It is for two products. So they are just like two questions. One part I will do, second part you will do on your own. I'll give you answer which you can certainly check. Product A is what I am doing. You are given the busted sale quantity. In the table, upper row is for product A. That is what I am using here. Busted sale quantity for January, February and March. Given in question. 3,400 and 4,200. Add closing stock. I read B point there. B point tells me about closing stock. Finished units equal to half the sale of next month will be in stock at the end of each month. At the end of each month, for example, I am talking 31st January. 31st January, my stock will be 50% of next month. 3400 into 50%, 1700. 29th Feb, 50% of 4200, 2100. Sale of April is given for this reason only, that I can compute for March. April sale is given 5000. So this, how did I get 50% of 5000, 2500. What about opening stock? 1st January stock is what? 31st December stock. 31st December night, whatever is left there will be there on 1st January morning. So it is 50% of same month sale. So this, what I am getting, this 1500, it is 50% of same month sale. It is 50% of 3400. This is 50% of 4200. Same month sale 50% is opening stock. Next month sale 50% is closing stock. Or I can say 31st December stock is same as 1st January. 1st February will be 31st January. 1st March will be 29th Feb and so on. So I can take from earlier month also. This earlier month stock corresponds to the next month stock also. This is what you can see. This 1700 is same as this 1700. This 2100 is same as this 2100. They can be related this way also. Or 50% on same month can also be done. Add less, what I get is busted production quantities. 3200, 3800 and 4600. Same way, make a table for product B. The answers you will be getting are given here. This is for you to practice on your own. For product B, you are getting 6000, 5600 and 4800. Do yourself. Only one odd part I am leaving for you. But you must do it and confirm that these are the busted production quantity units you are getting for month of January, February and March. Exactly same, just substitute the figures. Sale figures are going to change, everything else is same. Stocks obviously depend on the sale. Stocks will be computed based on the sale. 50% of next month is closing stock. 50% of same month is opening stock. So does this question deserve anything more than 4 marks? I don't think so. Maximum 4 marks question. Whatever marks it gives in exam, they are all free marks. You can easily enjoy those marks. Next question, B5, is a challenging question. It is a very good question as compared to last few questions that you have done. So let us focus on this. Read this B5 once. Now this B5 is first question that you are facing, which is not giving you busted sale quantity. In all questions, sale quantity was given. That was a starting point. From there, we computed production, from production consumption, from consumption purchase. We'll be doing same thing here, but what is missing? Budgeted sale units. If you read A part at the bottom, you are required to calculate A part, the number of units of product proposed to be sold. Busted sale quantity is to be computed in A part. It is not given, rather to be computed. Apply your logical mind. Don't get into trap. Just apply your logical mind. I tell you, my sales revenue is 10 lakh. And selling price per unit is 10. How many units did I sell? I ask this question to any logical man. He'll simply say, what the nuts you are talking about? It's very simple. Divide sales revenue with selling price. 10 lakh revenue divided by 10 per unit makes 1 lakh units. Very simple. If I can get sales revenue, I'll divide by selling price to get what? Sale units. In this question, sales revenue is directly given. Selling price I need to compute by making cost per unit statement. Recall earlier questions. Per unit variable cost we were computing. Here same way, per unit total cost I'll compute, add profit margin, I'll get selling price. Sales revenue divided by selling price will give me units to be sold. So look at the working which is related to selling price per unit. Sales revenue given in first line of the question, 126 lakhs. 126 lakh rupees. Divide by selling price, I'll get sale units. So concentrate on working for selling price per unit. That is the first working. Material cost. In the table, first item, rupees 6 per LBP. Second line of the question, each unit of product requires 3 LBS of material P. Material P, I need 3 LBS is pounds. Pounds is written as LBS. 3 LBS we need at the rate of 6 per LB. So that makes 18 rupees. Material Q, 1.5 LBS at the rate of 4 per LB makes 6 rupees. Labor, comprehensive labor hour rate in machine shop, 4 per hour. Third line of the question, 7 hours are required in machine shop. 7 hours, for 1 hour you are spending 4 rupees. So 28 rupees here. Similarly, assembly shop, 2.5 hours at the rate of 3.20 per hour. It is, table is matched with the first paragraph which is given to me. So from there I am getting 8 rupees. Fourth line of question, overheads are absorbed at blanket rate of 33.1/3% on direct labor. Absorption and all you'll understand just in a different chapter. Just put on total labor cost, 1/3 is overheads. 33.1/3% means 1/3. So 28 plus 8 is 36. 36 into 1/3. 26 into 1/3 makes 12 rupees. Add them all, you get total cost 72 rupees. 72 rupees per unit is total cost. Profit margin. In the question, second line, 20% profit on selling price. 20% on selling price implies 25% on cost, 1/5 on sale is 1/4 on cost. From there, I am simply getting 1/4 on 72, that is 18 rupees. Once I get there 18 rupees, my selling price per unit is 90. And once I get 90, 126 lakh divided by 90 results in 1,40,000 units. 1,40,000 units is my sale budgeted. Planned sale units are 1,40,000 units. Is this much clear? That is the base of the question. Question is still not over. There are some good points to come. But next part is similar to what you have done earlier. You've got sale, you want to reach purchase. What do you do? Remember, from sale, I will reach production. From production, I will reach consumption. From consumption, I will reach purchase. Once I get purchase quantity, apply the rate purchase cost per unit, I will get budgeted purchase cost. That is what question is wanting in the B part of the question. So B part is pretty simple, but it is dependent on A part. 1,40,000 unit is the starting point. So I get there. Busted sale quantity 1,40,000, add closing stock 25,000, closing and opening stocks, they are given at the bottom of the table. Table's second part, which is there. Stocks are given, finished goods and P&Q. Finished goods is being used here. I'm getting busted production of 1,45,000 units. Then I apply input-output ratio. Where is input-output ratio? Second and third line of the question. 3 LBS and 1.5 LBS applied on production units. I get in LBS, P&Q, consumption. Stock adjustment, the bottom part again, bottom part of the table, stock adjustment. Add closing stock, less opening stock. Find in the bottom part of the table, last line of the table, closing stock estimates for material P, 54,000, 33,000, closing stock 30,000, 66,000. They are adjusted here. What I get? Busted purchase quantity. Apply the rate. Rate is from table material P 6, material Q 4 per LB. From there, I am getting this cost. When added, you get this total. Aggregate is this. ₹34,68,000 is total busted purchase cost. Now comes the important part. Something new in this question, not there in any earlier question, may not be there even in the future questions to come. Unique point, you can mark it as important point of this question. I'll call it important part C. Concentrate on this. Capacity utilization. I can give formula for everything, but try to conceptualize. Try to understand what is the meaning of capacity utilization. What you are planning to do and what capacity you are having to do, they are related to get the capacity utilization. I take an example. Let us say you are having exams after 150 days. 150 days to go, you are having exams there. You are thinking to do 10 hours study. You are having availability of 1500 hours. Before the exams came, there are 150 hours, 150 days available. Every day you are going to study 10 hours. So 1500 hours are available to you. You want to solve 3000 questions. You want to solve 3000 questions. Every question will require 20 minutes. In 1 hour, 3 questions will be solved. 1 hour, 3 questions. Hours required before exams. Based on 3000 questions and 3 questions per hour, 1000 hours are required. Tell me, are you underutilized or overutilized? You are having availability of 1500 hours, but the questions will be finished in 1000 hours. You are underutilized. You have free 500 hours. You can study lesser. You can enjoy movies, songs, because you have extra 500 hours. If you had planned 6000 questions, you would have required 2000 hours. You would be overutilized. Means either do overtime, sleep less, eat less, enjoy less, study more. Then only you can complete those 6000 questions, because they require 2000 hours. You have availability of only 1500 based on your normal capacity of study. So capacity utilization is very simple. If I have to make a formula, this is formula in your case. Hours required for question divided by hours available into 100. If percentage is less than 100, you are underutilized. If percentage is more than 100, you are overutilized. Same thing applies in factories, in companies, in corporates. But they are not having questions. They are having production units. So the formula that you need to note and apply always is this. This is important for your understanding and application of this question. Capacity utilization is hours required for production divided by hours available for production into 100. In this question, there are two departments. We need to compute capacity utilization ratio for both the departments and then comment on the same. Comment on underutilization and overutilization. I have given you comments in writing, but you should understand first and not only copy and learn and put it in your answer sheet. You should understand. You can write in your own words always. I hope capacity utilization is understood. When hours available are more than hours required, there is underutilization. When hours required for production are more than hours available, then there is overutilization. You need to either recruit more labor or work more hours, so that overutilization can be taken care of. Here is computation. I'm doing for one department, second department you will do on your own in the same way. Here is hours required for production. 1,45,000 units, 7 hours per unit. In machine shop department, 7 hours are required to produce 1 unit. For 1,45,000 units required are 10,15,000 hours for production. This is numerator. Denominator, for one worker, I have availability of 240 hours. From where did I get? Question gives me in fourth line of the question, fifth line rather. The factory works 5 days, 8 hours a week for normal 52 weeks in the year. So gross hours available, gross hours I have computed 2080. Less all idle times, 96 hours, 80 hours, 64 hours, it is given in sixth line of the question. Leave, absenteeism, statutory holidays, they are all reduced 240 hours. So for every worker, there are 1840 hours available. How many workers are there in machine shop? In the table, second last column, number of employees in machine shop, 600. So when multiplied by 600 employees, I'm getting 11,04,000 hours. You need 10,15,000 hours. You have availability of 11,04,000 hours. Is it underutilized or overutilized? On the face of it, it is underutilized. There will be idle hours. You need less. You have more availability. So it is underutilized. Ratio is computed 91.94%. I hope this one is clear. This is special. It is not there in any other question. It is a unique question on this concept. Same thing you apply on assembly shop department. 1,45,000 multiplied by 2. There are workers which are given there. Number of workers are 180. 1840 into 180. This 3,31,200. From there I compute. This is the ratio. This is the key thing that you have to reach. 109.45. That is important. Percentage. Capacity utilization percentage. This is overutilized. Now what is the comment? I have asked this question in many classes. What my students normally respond? Sir, in first machine shop, they are free workers because there is underutilization. In assembly department, there is overutilization, there is a requirement of worker. So shift workers from machine shop to assembly shop. Is it that easy? No, it is not. The workers' caliber requirement will be different. Try to understand. It is a pharmaceutical company. Machine shop department, the repair workers and all, they are working. They are illiterate workers. In assembly shop department, there are qualified chemists who are eligible for working. Who can assemble medicines or pharma items? Only qualified chemists. Can you substitute an illiterate machine man into assembly department where you need qualified chemist? Generally, no. So you need to identify, is it possible to shift workers? If it is possible, yes, do it. If it is not possible, then what you can do? Then bear the underutilization or idle time in a machine shop department and fresh recruitment cost or overtime cost in assembly department. That is what we can comment. Similar things I have written here in the comment, which you can note and you can write in your own words also. This is the summary of the comments that we can make. The company should check the possibility of shifting some employees from machine shop department to assembly shop department. They should check the possibility. I am not saying that they should do it. Only check the possibility. If it is not technically or economically feasible, sometimes technically not possible, sometimes economically, you have to give lots of training for shifting and training is costing much more than the benefit. Better don't do the shifting. If it is not technically or economically feasible to shift, then company will bear the idle time cost or retrenchment consequences in machine shop department and overtime premium cost or fresh recruitment cost in the assembly shop department. If it is not possible to shift, bear the consequences. In both departments, there are some consequences. These consequences you will study in much more detail in labor costing chapter. Overtime concept, fresh recruitment concept, labor turnover concept, you will understand all in the labor costing chapter. But they are brief comments that we can make on this situation. I hope this one is clear. This was a really better and a good question to follow. Next question is B6. It's again carrying a small different concept which you need to understand. Other than that, it is very simple. It is giving in second table, third table rather, last table, normal loss in production. That is the only new point in the question. You need to understand what this normal loss means and what is the implication of the same. Whenever there is normal loss, there will be a concept of gross production and net production. There is something called gross production, there is something called net production. Exact detail of normal loss you will get in process costing topic, but I am just telling you loss which is expected, the percentage of which is predetermined. You already are thinking that this much loss will happen while we produce. If I produce 1 lakh units, 10% is a normal loss, only 90,000 will be saleable units of output. Means 10% out of units produced, 1 lakh. 10% of that, 10,000 units will be waste, will be rejected in quality. The quality inspection department will reject those units and they cannot be sold to my customer because they are not good units of output. So if I produce 1 lakh units, which is gross production, there will be loss of 10,000 units as per my previous experiences, that is expected 10%. 90,000 will be saleable units of output. Another name of saleable units is net production. So whenever there is a loss percentage given in question, I need to compulsorily calculate gross production as well as net production. Why net production is important? Because net production is dependent on what I am giving to outside customer, what I am keeping in my shop as closing stock, opening stock. All stock are good saleable units. They don't include the waste. Waste I don't keep at my showroom. I only keep the good units of output. Net production means good units of output. Why is gross production important? Because if I'll get to know gross production, then only I'll get to know my material consumption. Input output ratio is applied on gross production. Whereas sale units in stock, they are based on net production. The thing is, I gave you example, 1 lakh units we are thinking to produce. Out of that, 10% is loss and net we are able to get 90,000. In questions, I get production budget, sale, add, closing, minus opening. What I get is net production, not gross production. Good units to be sold, good unit stock, add, closing, minus opening. What I get? Good units. Good units is net production. Add normal stock, we will get gross production. That is the thing. So this is what you can note from here. Net production refers to good or saleable units produced. It can be computed as sale, add, target ending inventory, minus opening inventory. So our normal production budget will give me net production. Whenever there is normal loss predicted in production, gross production shall also be computed. The only question which is talking of loss. So whenever such loss is given, I need to compute the gross production also. Gross production represents total production, including normal loss or rejected units of output. Gross production is used to calculate consumption of material, which will help in reaching the purchase quantity. So for all material budgets, input-output ratio is applied on gross production units only. Normal loss can be computed as, this is an important formula which is given here. This is something to note. Net production into rate divided by 100 minus rate. That is important. This is something, the crux of the question that we are going to do. This is the only point which you need to focus on. Other than that, question is very simple. Let us do this question. We start with sales given in question. Sale is always of good units of output, not need to be written in this. Second table gives me that 60,000 units, 50,000 units and 80,000 units. Add target ending inventory. First table gives me inventory opening and closing. Target ending inventory 10,000, 8,000, 14,000. Less opening inventory 8,000, 9,000, 12,000. It is the second row in the first table. From there I am getting net production. What is most important in this question? Normal loss. This formula has been applied. This formula is being applied. 62,000 into 4 by 96, it will be approximated to the nearest unit because units cannot be in fraction. If it comes in fraction, we have to take to the nearest unit of approximation. 4 by 96, rate is 4%, 100 minus 4 is 96. 2% rate, 2 by 98. 6% rate, 6 by 94. The rates are given in third table, normal loss in production, due to which we are doing all this. Once I add, now students have a problem there. They say, sir, why not deduct? Just remember, what is formula? Gross minus loss is equal to net. That is the formula. So I need to compute gross is equal to net plus loss. So that is what I am doing there. Add net production, add normal loss. What I am getting is gross production. Gross production I am getting 64583. Approximated, cannot make it in fractions. 50,000 exact, 87234. It is again approximated to nearest units. So you can understand this different concept, which is for normal loss if it is given in question. What exactly is normal loss in much more detail you will get in the chapter of process costing. So we have done two different concepts in last two questions. In B5, we got concept of capacity utilization. In B6, we have got the concept of normal loss.